Seeing the presence of a quorum, we're going to call to order a regular meeting of the Amherst Regional School Committee, although it should be obvious since no one's going to be convening Union 26. This isn't a Union 26 meeting. I just wanted to say at the outset that we're endeavoring to schedule a joint Union 26 Amherst Regional School Committee meeting. If we can do it, I think we'd love to do it prior to the retreat on the 8th, which is the retreat scheduled for 6:30. If there was any way we could get a quorum at 5:30, it'd be great because we have some things to do in that meeting, like appointing the school committee members, doing the public lottery with the choice of the community member, as well as other discussion points around search that we can't conduct today because of the fact that we don't have Unit 26 present. So there will be communication, I think, from Deb tomorrow about the 8th. If people can check their calendars too, that'd just be helpful to get a sense of what that looks like and might be possible. It's all by way of the welcome and call to order, so I'm not fully not a voter on the agenda. I just talked a little bit about the need to do a meeting on the 8th and ideally at 5:30 if we can, since this isn't Union 26. We're not able to do Union 26 meeting today. Great. Approval of the minutes of February 14th, 2017, again for the regional portion of it. I don't know if people have had a chance to take a look at the minutes. I've only seen both edits and comments, well, edits really, and then a motion to approve if that's people are prepared to offer.
I move to accept the minutes.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, any edits? I'm going to pause for a second. I know that's more than a second, but I mean, I meant it colloquially.
I was just looking at you pleasantly.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Is the letter that Ms. Page had from public comments in these, are they in this minutes?
I don't see them attached here. I think we can request that the letter itself be attached to these minutes as approved. It's mentioned, though. It's meant, the letter's referenced in there.
That's particularly why I was asking if it's in it.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Okay. So I'm going to move to a vote, pausing ever so slightly as I do so. Let's have a look. Okay. All those in favor of approving the minutes, February 14th, please raise your hand, signify.
As amended.
As amended, I'm sorry, thank you. If that's unanimous, so the minutes are approved. Wonderful. So, we'll, and you know, I could have waited for my whole March 8th thing until announcements and public comment, I guess, but I'm just such an enthusiast for school committee work that I couldn't handle it.
I know the feeling.
Steve is asking who's
for some minutes. Sure. So, Ms. Westmoreland is not able to be here tonight, so she's going to take the minutes based on the video. I'll take the minutes in terms of if there are pending motions that need to be repeated before people vote.
Okay.
But she wasn't unable to be here tonight, as was the person who's usually her replacement. So she, thanks to Amherst Media, she will be taking accurate notes from there.
Okay.
If it pleases the committee.
Terrific. Okay. So are there any announcements from the committee? Is that it?
I was going to mention it in the superintendent update, but you certainly, we don't have to do it then.
Okay. I can
one of you. Jump in.
Well, we can want to start.
Sure. So I want to share from my perspective news, which was that last night the Massachusetts Board of Elementary and Secondary Education voted 7-2 to deny the expansion of a local charter school. And I want to thank many people, but I think in particular the members of all four of our towns, whether it was the school committee, select boards, finance committees, as well as many citizens, really activated around this issue in supporting our local schools. And also, I think what felt particularly good to me was about affirming our stance on integrated and diverse schools as being critical to our belief system. So I'll let others, you know, Catherine, who is there, speak to this. I'll mention tomorrow night, but Kara Castenson, who is the chair of the Pelham, had an incredibly powerful, she was the first public speaker, and just incredibly powerful statement, I think, as I said earlier, casually, fitting as much as she fit in 2.5 minutes about the value of Pelham schools was pretty incredible to watch. And there is a video, so I can send that to the committee if people want to watch that. It starts at like 29 minutes of the first part is other schools, other board business. But it was unexpected is the other piece. I mean, the chair of the State Board of Education spent $100,000 of his own dollars trying to pass question two. Has been a reliable yes vote on charter expansion or new charter schools, and voted, was moved by the arguments that he heard from our communities, as well as some other surrounding communities. So it was a pretty powerful evening.
Yeah, I guess Superintendent has summed it up really well. It was a surprise, and I think a very happy surprise, and I think even more powerful was the size of the vote, which was 7-2, and one of the two was basically saying, "I'm voting," sort of knowing that this is going to not pass, and sort of a pat on the back to the charter school, and saying, "You know, keep up the good work." But what I also wanted to reiterate what the superintendent also said about the chair of the Pelham School Committee, who did a really incredible job setting the tone. And I was sitting there thinking, you know, she's basically saying, I am here to save the Pelham Elementary School. And she described the school, and she described not just what a wonderful school it was, but it's the center of the community, and she was so compelling. And I thought all the speakers, the superintendent, Mr. Demling, and a gentleman from East Hampton, Peter Gunn,
who's on their school committee.
Who was on their school committee, a school committee member, each took a sort of a piece of the argument, and when you put it all together, I was thinking as I was listening, there is no way anybody in this room can vote for this charter school to expand at this point. So I just want to thank everybody who spoke, and also thank committee members who activated and community members who activated. But the other thing I wanted to say is that at the very end of the meeting and after the vote, the board made clear that the charter school can come back at any time, because it's an addendum, to request the expansion again. They don't even have to wait until next February, but they could do it in June or July, or, you know. And I know that the charter school has every intention of doing that. So I think that we have to think as a committee, we have to think as four communities, sort of what we do at this point, knowing that that's going to be sort of an ongoing struggle. And, you know, it's one of the things that I was also thinking is that the way in which this charter school and all charter schools are funded are now sort of pitting our schools against this particular charter school. And I think there sounds like there are some very good things happening in that charter school, but, you know, if they expand, it's going to impact our public schools incredibly and significantly. So we have talked before on this committee about advocacy around various issues, and I think this particular issue is one that I hope the regional committee and other school committees take very, very seriously. Mm-hmm. And sort of are leaders in that advocacy. So, but I really want to commend the superintendent for leading the charge in such a strategic and smart and you know, data-driven way.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I thought that was exceptional. Is there any other comments? And it's actually, did anyone else? Ms. Sullivan, do you have anything to say on this? No? Sure?
Mm-hmm.
I saw a neat note from you the other day. It was actually very nice.
I have one more announcement.
Sure. Dr. Ortiz, I'm sorry.
If you have an announcement.
No, please. Just, it's on the same topic.
Our congratulations and glad, you know, this is a great, what I would describe as reprieve. As we go forward and thinking about how we're going to respond to how the world is moving, I want to caution us to be careful of falling into the trap of pitting it as an us versus them. The Chinese charter school, I wouldn't say, has some good things going on. I'll say it's a school, and just like parents with children, has great things going on with great things to offer students. And our fundamental problem is not with the existence of a charter school, but with the way it financially impacts us. And that was done by design. So this is as you are correctly putting it, a temporary reprieve, because they can apply for this in any way, shape, or at any point. But it behooves us to, I think, strategically focus our attention on the funding for charter schools writ large, and use this as an example of why or how charter schools can undermine public schools. I want the Chinese charter immersion school to continue. I just don't want it to continue at the expense of Pelham School or Amherst Regional School or those things. And so I want to caution us, as well as advocates in the community, from falling into the trap of it being us versus them, it being an establishment versus a new way of doing things. We're all the old way of doing things, parents who want to make sure our children are educated. What we are particularly attacking is the divide and conquer things that are systemically put in to segregate communities. We don't want to be segregated. We are not segregated from the people that go to the Chinese immersion school. But for the money, that would be obvious. It's the money and the funding mechanism for it that creates the schism, and that's what we all should be attacking. So again, kudos to us all, especially Dr. Morris, especially chair people of committees, including my committee, the Pelham Committee, I'm very proud of, and the Pelham School. But I don't want this to be framed in such a way where it can be used against us or the Chinese immersion school as versus.
I'd echo what the other comments earlier. I thought that members of the community, the superintendent in particular, as well as the committees, did an exceptional job of organizing very rapidly and doing so in a fact-based way. And I think that fact-based way underlines the notion that people were actually trying not to attack the validity of a charter school, but rather focus on the impact that it had on our district. And I think even the demographic argument did a nice job of focusing on sort of the differential impact, as well as some extent the mission. So there's a little bit of there's obviously an implicit critique there, but that wasn't the fundamental argument. And I think that's one of the reasons why, going from last Thursday when we met to the final presentations and arguments you were making, I thought everyone did a wonderful job of honing in on the arguments that were in fact most likely to be persuasive to the board, which is the key thing in the end, right? We can feel good about ourselves, but the bottom line is moving the vote. And I think you did an exceptional job of moving the vote. And I think we should pick this up again. I mean, I completely agree. I've been talking, I have a bunch of friends in the Boston area as well as out here who are involved in, you know, the MTA and the MFT and stuff, and issues around charter school funding. And there's a sort of a buzz of the question of, after question two's right. defeat, what's the most next logical thing to focus on this issue? And I tend to agree that there's some folks who talk about going after other education priorities in a way that I think is almost overstating the victory or misinterpreting the victory.
Right.
I mean, that's just my personal opinion.
But I
think that the core of this question of how long can we bleed and underfund Chapter 70, how long can we bleed our accounts and undercut the quality of local programming, district programming, based on the insufficiency of charter funding, and how do we solve that? Those questions, I think, are the core of the vote last November, and those are things that I think are highly worth going after, and that ends up going into programmatic stuff as well. So I don't want to belabor this. What I really want to do is pick it up and say we should talk about this at another regional meeting as an actual topic that we get into. So with your blessing, I'd love to do that. Yes?
Yeah. I'm just wondering, in preparation for such a discussion, because proponents of charter schools will say, well, every town has a district has a 9% cap on their spending, and it's set up that way to protect the districts from it being, you know, too much, and the districts need to prepare for that when a charter school goes in. Would it be possible to break that down in terms of how close we are to that in the different districts and the different schools, and how, like, get the real nuts and bolts of how that would affect each district?
In a future meeting.
I was just going to say, yes.
I thought you were going to answer the question.
No. It's data we have and very easily accessible, and I think we can walk the committee through that easily.
I think in general that the concept of structuring a conversation in which it is very fact-based and it's very sort of walking through the different aspects of it, and then figuring also then, if we can do intelligence in advance, what might be our options to advocate, would actually be a really valuable exercise for us.
Right. I would advocate the premise of that is false on its face, but we need the data to be able to make that argument.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm also just talking about moving from educating ourselves to thinking about different options for action.
Right.
Okay, are there other announcements? I want to the public comments in a second. Ms. Happy.
Yes, I just wanted to let the committee know and the audience and people watching at home that this weekend Anything Goes is being put on by the high school. And I encourage everybody who can to see the show. It's supposed to be fantastic. The high school puts on, is well known for putting on just wonderful, wonderful musicals. And this one is supposed to be really great. I've been hearing buzz.
I was actually at the water fountain up a little ways. I was hearing they were rehearsing, and it sounded wonderful. The voices just sounded wonderful. All the students were super excited getting ready to perform and stuff. So it was neat. It's honestly, you know, we're going to have to work hard to make this meeting a lot of fun, because my guess is what they're doing up there is more fun. So we'll keep at that. And just to repeat the comment I made earlier, in case you weren't aware, because this is not a joint Union 26 regional committee meeting, we're not going to be discussing the superintendent's search process. What we're endeavoring to do right now is set up a meeting for March 8th at 5:30. That would be the sole focus of that agenda, would be to discuss and update the work of the search process, appoint the school committee members to the screening committee, get into the weeds and any instructions we have for Ray and Associates and for the screening committee around how it'll function, including how it'll assess applications and things like that from superintendent candidates. So I just wanted to, and then also do the lottery for the community member who, if people are watching at home, you can still submit your name to be chosen at random to be a community member on the screening committee. I wanted to lay that out in case people weren't aware of it. But now, how about public comments? Are there any?
I do have a comment.
Oh, yeah. You have an announcement?
A very quick one. Okay. This is regarding our the unanimous vote to bring food services back in-house. And so I was able to make that announcement. There were a few hundred people there at the UU in Amherst. It was a climate action now coming together and Amherst Branch NAACP, as well as many other groups, event on climate justice. And so now people are inquiring and are excited that this is happening. So I would like to at least, or I think as a district, we should make a formal announcement that has happened to inform the community. I think they're natural allies. There are many people that want to that initiative to bring in clean, locally sourced foods into our cafeteria.
I'll come back to that. Maybe when we get to the budget presentation, if that would be okay.
Great. Are there any public comments? If there are, come forward, identify yourself. You have at most 3 minutes.
Hi, Peter Demling. So just a quick follow-up on the comment, really, on the Board of Ed meeting last night. So I totally hear what Dr. Baptiste is saying, that, you know, if charter schools aren't going away, public schools hopefully are not going away as well. So for the foreseeable future, we have to coexist with both models, right? And so we don't want there to be an us versus them. We have to, I mean, if any state can do it, right, Massachusetts should be able to find a way to coexist. And so to focusing on this bigger picture of the broken funding model, which I'm presuming most of us feel the funding model is broken, is certainly essential first step, right, to making sure that that conversation, that hopefully is a conversation between charter school management in our area and public schools in our area, is cordial. But you know, there is another sort of layer to this that makes it even more difficult, and this is why I was kind of concerned about leaving the BOE meeting last night, which was the simple fact that we lose a ton of money because the model is broken is not a compelling argument to this commissioner and to this Board of Education. I mean, you guys can watch the tape, but my sense was that the thing that really compelled them was that the Hadley Charter School had not made the argument that they needed the expansion, that they justified the enrollment. There's a lot of very positive comments about the quality of education, and that was never an argument about the quality of education for the students that they serve. And they really seem to want to approve it. And like Ms. Appy said, they were encouraging that, you know, you don't have to wait a year. Come back when you, basically saying, come back when you're more organized. And so, so at the end of the day, I think the more compelling sort of way is not to go to the board and say, hey, look, this is clear that we're losing money, because that's not going to convince this board, I don't think, to a majority. I think it's more to try and distinguish that this is a public school. A charter school is a public school, which operates under different demands and a different mission than a private school. And the core of that mission is education for all, not just for high achievers, not just for those who struggle. So I don't have a solution, but just another layer to the complex problem. Thank you.
Thanks. Any other comments? Okay. Seeing none, we'll close the public comment section. Do we have an interim superintendent?
Yeah, I'll be brief.
Yeah. No, just usually they're on their table. With
yeah, I'm sorry. Without Debbie, I'm
not nearly as good.
We'll take that as a as part of your report. You're praising Debbie.
Yes. Every time I should do that. So there's five items today. I think I'll just briefly point out perhaps the last four, but since we've already spoken about the first one. The second one I want to spend just probably the most time on, which is this Saturday, March 4th, from 3 to 5:30, there's a community-wide meeting at Grace Episcopal Church in Amherst, and it's really focused on the immigration question, which I know is on our agenda, but I thought it would be important for me to share this at this point. The organizers asked me to reach out to the committee, and if anyone would like to come, or is able to come, there's the resolution passed, at least by the Amherst School Committee. We'll see how things go tonight for the region. Will be recited, and all the school committee members in attendance are invited up to the stage for that that reading. And it is kind of a partnership. There will be the town manager will be there. Some of the select board members will be there. I'll be there. So it was just an invitation I wanted to share with you, and then also share because we're on camera, and there's other people who might be interested in going. They're expecting a couple hundred people to come to this event. The third, number three. Oh, yeah.
I don't know if folks are interested in going. But
I'm interested in going.
I'll go.
Okay, mm-hmm. Great.
I think McGovern's going to be there as well.
Great. Yeah, I saw that today.
I figured it was a nice moment that if anyone was going, they could express it. So absolutely. We wouldn't leave it a mystery to the fourth to see if anyone shows up.
I'll be there.
Great.
Please go.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
No, go ahead.
Is it appropriate to share this announcement to, like, as a school-wide announcement?
So I can ask the organizers. I don't, since the schools aren't organizing the event, I don't know what they want their capacity. I don't know what the capacity of the church is, so I'm not quite sure. What I can definitely do is I will get in touch with them tomorrow morning and ask.
Yeah, because you have like, Friday.
Yeah, yeah, we could certainly put in the Friday update, but I want to make sure that they're comfortable with me doing that.
That's right.
You know, we don't end up with, I don't think they would mind having more people than they can handle, but I also don't know. I don't know what the church's capacity is. So I will email them tomorrow morning. Thank you for that idea. The third one, again, coming up later, we'll talk about homework at the regional level, but I just want to share that I'm working with Lauda, Dr. Valdivieso, who's the interim dean of the teacher education department at the College of Education at UMass. And the questions that have come up at least the Amherst and Pelham School Committee levels, and then I'm sure will come up tonight. She's working with her team on coming up with a presentation and kind of annotated bibliography so that we come back in May and June and work with a stakeholder group that we'll be organizing at that point to try to make recommendations before the end of the year. But Dr. Valdivieso has been great to work with, very enthusiastic, and we're trying to kind of build some more bridges between the university's College of Education and then our district as well, which has been great. And it's nice that we don't have to Skype or, you know, her office is 2.5 miles from my office. So mm-hmm. It makes the whole thing work a lot smoother.
And she's good people.
She is. The fourth one tomorrow, 12:30. I'm not going to read the whole thing because this is kind of the press release that the high school organized. Thanks, Mark, for getting it out to me. 12:30 near the cafeteria, there's kind of the bottle filler system that you see at a lot of colleges, university campuses. We're opening that up. It's a collaboration of a lot of folks, students, families, as well as school staff. So just kind of a fun, nice one, but also just kind of neat thing. And the last one, which has been, we've spoken about before, but I think there's three or four members.